Good morning everyone. In today's session we are going to talk about the process of mass communication. Let's begin. These are the key features through which mass communication is possible. The first one is content must be suitable for mass distribution. Every kind of content that we create or anybody who wants to create or is a part of the mass communication process must keep that in mind, that the content must be suitable for mass distribution. Now let's look at what mass distribution is. If you go back to the earlier session where we talk about interpersonal communication and group communication, I said that there is a limited amount of people who are involved in this communication process. Whereas in mass communication, we have a larger audience. So because there is a larger audience, it is not practically possible to meet everyone or each of them and converse or pass on what are messages that we want to spread. But so what we need to do is we need to create a content which can be delivered or passed on to the larger segment of the society or the large base of consumers at the same point in time. So mass distribution plays a very key role in sending the content out. So we must create content or must design content in a way in which it could be passed on to the larger segment of the society. And we must also design or work on a design through which mass distribution is possible. This is primarily the reason why we use mediated forms of communication. What are mediated forms of communication? Like I told you yesterday while winding up the class, that mass communication is increasingly device driven. Like I speak to you through this smartphone, and this content that is being created could be uploaded on cloud, and n number of users can benefit from the content that I'm producing. Similarly, there are newspapers, there are radio, there is the television, and there are films through which any kind of content that are suitable for the masses are sent out in one go, and majority of the people consume that. So mass distribution becomes a very crucial aspect of the process of mass communication. Mediated content for heterogeneous audience is the next point. I spoke about mediated content. Any content that is passed on to people through a device, through a technological device, through a radio, through a newspaper, or a magazine, or a journal, or through television, or through cinema, is a mediated content. And it is for the heterogeneous audience. I spoke about which audience could be called as heterogeneous audience, which audience could be called as homogeneous audience. Why this audience base is called heterogeneous? Because we don't know the audience. Their takeaways from the content that the whosoever is involved in the mass communication process, whosoever is creating content, their takeaways are different. Okay, those people who are consuming, they are largely the audience. The people who are consuming the content are diverse in nature. Each of us have our own exposure, our own understanding of the world, so, and our knowledge also. So all these things play a very crucial role in assimilating content, in understanding or internalizing the content that is passed on to us. And whatever we consume, we process it and we understand it in our own way. So this audience is heterogeneous. This audience is not somebody who is in direct contact with the people who are creating content in a mass communication setup. So that is crucial that we pay attention to who heterogeneous audience or anonymous audience is and how they consume the content which is mediated in nature. Okay. The third part is no physical proximity with the audience. Okay. The people who consume mass mediated content are usually away from the people who create content. How does that work? Like for example, I am delivering this lecture, and for each of you, I don't know. Okay, I'm yet to meet you guys. Similarly, those people who read television news or who make films, when they're making films, they don't know which audience is going to come and watch the film, or when a person, a newspaper company is putting out content in newspapers, they don't know who their readers are. Okay, individually they don't know who their readers are. As unlike in interpersonal communication, where you meet people face to face and you interact or engage on an everyday basis. So this thing is not possible when we talk about mass communication. So there is no physical proximity to the audience. People are far away. They consume content sitting in comfortably at their homes, and they consume content on a regular basis. Fourth point is institutional production and distribution. This part is also crucial. Institutionalized production and distribution. Okay, I could be an individual content creator. You know, there are several individual content creators you see, you come across. A lot of them are people who create content for YouTube at their homes, and people who write blogs, and people who make films independently. Those people are individual content creators. And then there are institutional productions also. What is institutionalized production? Institutionalized production is one in which the focus is primarily on institution driven content. For example, you know, Times of India or Hindu, or radio channel like FM, radio FM, or a film company for that matter. They are institutions, and they produce content, and they have their own channels of distribution of that content that they produce. So institutional production and distribution helps in propagating or spreading the message through the process of mass communication. Fifth point is controlled process of production. Yesterday I spoke about what a controlled process of production is. Briefly, I'm going to talk about it in a little detailed manner today. Okay, controlled process of production. Why is it essential to control the content? Why it is important to control the content is because unless you have some sort of a control over your content, it is going out there and people are making different kind of meanings out of it. Okay, it is not practically possible to put out every kind of content that you have. So the content has to be structured. So whoever is consuming content, the content is intended or targeted towards them. For example, like I told you yesterday, if I'm somebody who is a sports lover, who is somebody who is largely interested in any kind of sport, would possibly pick up a sports magazine or a sports e-zine or watch content which is related to sports. It could be a sports film, it could be a match commentary, so on and so forth. So unless I am targeting towards a certain audience, okay, I might not know the audience, so it should not be misconstrued with the heterogeneous audience. If there is a heterogeneous audience, if you don't know, I said that if we don't know the audience, we don't know the audience, then how do we say that we are controlling content? We are controlling content to direct it towards a certain kind of audience. When I say certain kind of audience, it's still mass. Okay, but only thing is it's targeted. So what I need to do is, or anybody who is creating content for that matter, in a mass communication setup, what they do, whether it is newspapers, magazine, journals, or television or radio, they create segments or sections through which they approach different kind of audience. And they're always target audience driven. The content in a mass communication setup is always target audience driven, because we are not having a physical one-on-one, or we are not having a physical conversation within a group. So because it is targeted towards a heterogeneous audience and they have their own different takeaways, we try to segment the content. Yesterday I spoke briefly about how on radio, there are programs for kids to listen to. There are programs which are related to agriculture, which are largely beneficial as far as information is concerned for those farmers or people who are involved in the process of agriculture. So the content is always targeted and it is controlled. And if there is no regulation of content, it can create different kind of chaos. So controlled process of production and distribution is key or an important area of the process of mass communication. Next point is large audience. The audience is extremely large when we talk about mass communication. That is the reason why we attach mass to the process of communication, because it's huge. Okay, what the large audience does, is they consume content on a regular basis. And it is important that you target the content at the same point in time towards everybody, whoever is interested in that kind of content. So the audience is large, that's why it is not possible to have group communication or interpersonal communication. So mass communication, some form of message reproduction, okay? It's not some form of message production, it says some form of message reproduction. Why is message reproduction important? Message reproduction helps in proliferation of, you know, the content. Okay, I watch, let's say for example, I watch a film. I like the film and I recommend that film to somebody. That somebody watches the film and he or she likes it and he or she passes on the same information to somebody else. In a theater, there's so many people. People coming from different backgrounds, coming together to watch one film. Or, newspaper is distributed across. And, you know, poor people, rich people, whoever is interested to know what is happening across the world, they all come together at their own spaces to read the same content. So the content remains the same. And what they do with that content is they reproduce it in some way. This leads to, for example, in newspapers, whatever content is put out there, you know, it could be opinion-based pieces, it could be the general news that you read, you tend to discuss what is happening across the world. When you are trying to discuss it out with the world, it could be a family member's friend, it becomes, you know, a key conversation material. Cinema becomes a key conversation material. You listen to a certain particular kind of music, you like that, you recommend it to a friend, that friend listens to that music, he or she spreads it across. That's how content also goes viral in digital communication. When we talk about digital communication on new media, you'd get to know how the concept of virality works. For now, the message reproduction happens in this way, and it's a very key area or a key aspect of the mass communication process. Because message reproduction happens, the audience base grows. Because message reproduction happens, there is diversity in terms of content, because it spreads, it becomes a conversation material and it spreads from person to person. It could be individual consuming the content and then reproducing it in their own ways, understanding, assimilating content and passing it on, and then the other person passes it to the other person, and that's how the content spreads. So some form of message reproduction happens in the process of mass communication. Rapid distribution and delivery. What does it focuses on? Rapid distribution and delivery. Because it is mediated, remember I said VDCO, its mass communication is device driven, and we require some sort of a device or the other in order to pass on the information. Because it is device driven, it is recorded and then spread across, or through newspaper for that matter. The content, like I told you, remains the same, but the delivery or the distribution part becomes rapid. It's in one go. So I record this content, I upload it out there, it's done in one go. An institution produces a newspaper, which a newspaper company produces a newspaper, and then it passes on to people in one go. So one day's production and it goes out to the people. Newspaper is still the traditional form of media, and it still runs through the day. I mean, the content that you read in today's newspaper, then you again wait for 24 hours for the next day's newspaper, the next edition of newspaper, to arrive with a fresh content. Whereas as against that, if you listen to radio news bulletins would come for 4 times a day. And then in television, you have 24 hours news programming. What happens is there is live news, right? You get to see people reporting from different parts of the world, offering you content almost real time, or what we understand as deferred live, which is for a very short span of time. The journalist reaches there and then offers you what is happening from the ground. So rapid distribution and delivery of content. So from one particular space, people create content and it is spread out to people across the world. There are so many content creators on YouTube, you would know, who work from home basically, or who go out, in a, let's say for example, the comics, stand-up comics, they work from home. So most of the times producing content, meme creators, people who go out there in public spaces, maybe they, and those programs are televised and put it out there on OTT platforms. And then we enjoy the pace. We enjoy the content at our own pace. So the point being that it's done in one go. Next point is low cost to the consumers. How much does a newspaper cost? A newspaper barely costs $10, okay? Most of the times you have a device, you have a radio, you just tune on, and then, or you know, you have a FM channels are there on mobile phones these days. So you listen to this content, whatever is put out there. So it's the device cost that you're paying for, which is most of the time one time, or maybe if you're, you know, if you subscribe to you know, platforms like YouTube or paid versions or Netflix or Amazon, whatever content you want to consume or you consume on a regular basis, these are very cheap you know, and effective ways of getting consuming content. So it's always low cost to consumers. It's one time most of the times, and then you pay a monthly subscription, which is barely anything as against the production cost. The last part is the feedback. In this segment, the last part is the feedback is indirect, non-existence and delayed. Yesterday I spoke briefly about feedback. Let's take it up. Feedback is indirect. Why do I say so? Feedback is indirect because, remember, it's not interpersonal communication. It's not group communication where you meet people on you know, on a regular basis, face to face, and you interact or exchange or share whatever your thoughts are or they share. So when I am saying something to you and you say, you know, you respond or react to whatever I say, the feedback is instantaneous in nature. Whereas in the case of mass communication, because the audience is huge, and it's a one-way form of communication. When somebody is putting news out there, the person is not expecting an immediate feedback from the response. Irrespective of whether the content is great or bad, they don't receive feedback immediately. So the feedback is indirect. You could reach out to you know, the newspaper company through letters to the editor. You could reach out to the news channel through writing an email to them saying the content is not appropriate, or you really appreciate the groundbreaking reporting that a certain journalist has done, so on and so forth. But it's still indirect in nature, it's not direct. The next part is non-existent merely, because many a times you would not be able to, you know, assimilate that kind of content or feedback coming from the audience. So like, for example, in YouTube, those things are possible because these are digital mediums. But when you talk about the other form of traditional form of mass communication, newspapers, radio, television, primarily newspaper, radio, television, you would not see too much of audience intervention. What we understand as audience intervention or audience feedback, it's barely there. Okay, handful of people write letters to the editor, but that is not the amount of people who are reading newspapers. The newspaper is read across by a lot of people, but do they do the audience actually get a scope or an opportunity to offer feedback all the time? No, it is not possible. They consume and they reproduce that content somewhere else, but they are not the ones who most of the times offer feedback. So the structure, the system of feedback is mostly non-existent in this case. And last part is delayed. Okay, why do we say that this conversation between the people who are consuming information or consuming any kind of content and the people who are creating is somehow delayed? The relationship is something that is driven through feedback most of the times. Okay, audience like a certain cinema, they go and watch. Audience read newspapers they subscribe to different newspapers. There are a lot of, you know, newspaper wars. You would see there are channels who come up with this tagline that we offer breaking news and we offer news first. Why do this do so? These are all marketing strategies or gimmicks in order to attract a larger audience base, because they know that they can't get the direct feedback from the audience or the consumers, whosoever is consuming their content. So the feedback in most of the cases is delayed. Even if, let's say, for example, I write a letter to the editor, to the newspaper office, because I liked a certain content. It could be an opinionated piece or an editorial piece, or I didn't like the way they kind of targeted a particular group in their newspaper content. If I write to them, there's a possibility that I might not ever receive a feedback from them, or my feedback would not reach them. There are thousands of people who are writing to them. This is shortlist and select. So many times I might not fall into that scope or the opportunity of getting a feedback regarding this. So feedback is indirect. It's non-existent in most of the cases, or it is delayed. So these are largely what the features of mass communication is. Now let's run through a little bit about how the process happens and why it is crucial to run you through this. Okay, there are four key areas we need to focus. These are, you could call them stakeholders, you could call them elements, features, however you want to understand. But remember, these four structures are very crucial when we talk about understanding what the process of mass communication is. First one is sender. Who is a sender? The person who is creating content. Okay, it could be an individual, it could be an individual working for an institution or the institution itself, whosoever is putting it out there. For example, I could be an independent content creator creating content and putting it out in cloud or on YouTube for that matter. So I work independently, and at that point in time, whatever message that I want to put it out there, I am the sender. The message I want to communicate with the world, I want to share my thoughts and feelings and ideas around everything, whatever I feel or whatever I intend to put it out there, I become the sender or the source through which the content is produced. So source or the sender plays a very significant role, is the primary stakeholder in the process of mass communication, because without a source or a sender, the process of mass communication would not be possible. Like, remember, in interpersonal communication, you require a person to begin the conversation. Here, in this case, the sender or the source is that person, or the institution for that matter, is that is that body which puts the content out there. And it is crucial that we understand the role and responsibilities of this person. So sender is the person who sends content, or the source. And what do? They produce content, and there is a content that is produced that is targeted towards the newspaper story, the magazine story, the program that you're listening on radio, the television report, news report that you see, or the film that you watch. All these things are nothing but messages, okay, of different kinds. What kind of messages? Messages are of different kind. Whatever the sender intends to send out there in order to communicate to the world becomes the message. And how do we do so? How do the sender puts out the message? The sender does so through a channel. The channel, remember, is the medium through which this message is sent. Okay, channel could be different. Channel could be a newspaper, channel could be a television channel could be radio, channel could be cinema. So any medium that the content creator is using in order to put content across to the receiver is the channel. Okay, channels are of different kinds, and content are created accordingly. You cannot create newspaper content and put it out in cinema, or you can't write a story for cinema and put it out in newspaper. These are two different mediums. There's a nature of production of this content, and then you put the content accordingly. The last part is the receiver. Okay, who the receiver? Who is the receiver? The receiver is you and me. Anybody who consumes content, anybody who intends to consume content of different kind. Okay, so your grandfather or your parents or you, whosoever is reading the morning newspaper every day and trying to discuss it with others, sharing the worldviews, are the receivers. Anybody who goes out there to watch, you know, films, or anybody who is switching on a television channel and listening to the primetime news, they are the receivers. There are different names to them, but primarily we call them receivers because they are the ones who are at the receiving end of the content. Okay, this is the sender, this is the message, this is the channel, this is the receiver. So primarily this is how the process of mass communication works. Like I told you, feedback is also there, and feedback is also a key process in mass communication, but most of the times non-existent. That's why we don't consider it generally when we talk about mass communication in this section, when to begin with. Okay, so what we need to do is we need to look at why this process is crucial, why this process, why there is a structure at place through which this process of mass communication happens. You know, in intrapersonal or interpersonal or group communication, the communication or the content production, design, delivery is very direct in nature. Here there is an indirect nature to the entire process of mass communication. You create content that are suitable for audience. The audience is heterogeneous and anonymous. Most of the times you don't know the audience. The content reaches to them. It's in known ways. So it's not something that most of the times we have some control over. Okay, you know, as fellow audience or fellow receivers, we don't have much of control over that. The transmission process of any content is possible because somebody is interested in looking for a target audience most of the times. So the target audience plays a very crucial role, even if they're anonymous or heterogeneous. So, you know, when you are addressing such a large mass of audience, what do? You want to say something. Okay, for example, at one point in time, when Christianity started, all the content that is put out there by those people who were interested, you know, to spread religious messages, they would go travel from villages to villages or from one place to another, and then gather a group of people, and then they start propagating those messages. From that stage to a stage when, you know, printing technology came handy, and the text that we produced, then there was Bible, and then through Bible, a lot of people could have access to those kind of sermons or, you know, religious speeches or whatever is there in the content. So this thing is possible because of a technology. So the Bible or the printed material became the primary content or the medium through which these messages could be passed on to a lot of people. So the popularity of a religion, the popularity of those people who are creating content is possible, or they become a little more powerful than they were because there is a medium through which you can reach out to a large number of people at the same point in time. The very fact that the concept of virality works, or any message could be spread across, is possible because there is a medium and there is a process at place. So mass communication plays a very significant role in spreading messages across to people at the same point in time. So I hope this content is useful for you, and then I'll see you in the next class. Thank you so much.